always done it.
Hello? Yes. Hello. It's raining and my audience has just doubled. That's great. Hello. Oh, no, go. Anybody wants to go and hit the rain, do. I'd rather not do it with a mic, but I've been told it's better and it's raining and you can't hear me. My name's Tamasin Cave. I work for a group called Spinwatch. There's a post. You can see me on that side. We monitor the public relations and commercial lobbying industry in this country. So we're a couple of academics and a couple of investigative journalists, and we're all over the country. We're a very small team, but that's basically what we do. We look at a range of different lobbies, from the oil lobby, the tobacco lobby. We are doing some work on fracking at the moment. I look at public sector, so looking at the privatisation of education and health. We also look at some more contentious lobbies like the Israel lobby, and we're looking at the Islamophobia movement at the moment. So there's a whole range of things. And I want to talk to you a little bit about how commercial lobbying works in the UK. Some of you will know, some of you will be activists, you'll have run up against corporate lobbyists, probably quite a lot. But it's quite useful to talk through their tactics and some of the techniques that they use, because it crosses all sectors. So it will be the same when, you know, people are wanting to get a slice of the NHS, they'll use the same tactics as the tobacco lobby. So it's kind of, it's useful to look at, yeah, some of their tactics. And I think the way that we'll do it is I'm going to ramble through stuff, hopefully not ramble, but if you've got a question or you want to say something or you've got some experience, you want to chip in or whatever, stick your hand up and we'll do it as we go along, because that'll be more interesting than me just talking at you. It's useful to just to say what lobbying is. If you've ever contacted your MP, gone on a demo, petitioned the government about anything, you are lobbying. That's what you do. You're trying to influence the decisions of government. And that is basically what lobbying is. And in that context, lobbying is a very good thing. It's part of a healthy democracy. We want and expect our politicians to listen to us. They often don't. But that's basically what lobbying is. But that's not what I'm going to talk about, because that's kind of the theory of lobbying. And I'm going to talk about the actuality of what lobbying looks like in this country. And that is a £2 billion commercial for-profit industry dominated by corporations. And the reason why they lobby is not because they, you know, they want to contribute to democracy and make a healthier society. They do it for profit. So it's a tactical investment made by corporations, a way of making money. It's another way of making money. It's like tax avoidance. So what they will do is they will lobby for one or two things mainly. Either government presents them with a threat. It could be a tax hike. It could be regulation, new legislation. And they will lobby against it. Or government could present them with an opportunity, which is, if you take something like the NHS reforms, that is a £100 billion opportunity for the private healthcare industry. So they're either opening up markets or seeking to regulate in some way or penalise companies. And that's why they lobby. And they invest in it. And it's the investment is proportionate to the opportunity or to the threat. So if you take something like the tobacco industry, and it's waged a 50-60-year war against regulation and against public health measures, and they have scaled the level of investment to the level of business that they're going to be losing, so the market that they would be losing. You see the alcohol industry do it at the moment. The gambling industry are using exactly the same tactics as tobacco and alcohol have done before them, and they are spending hundreds of millions of pounds and dollars because that's the threat that is posed to them by regulation and legislation and the like. So it's just worth keeping in mind that it is a way of making money. And that's why they do it, and that's why we have a very, very healthy £2 billion commercial lobbying industry in this country. It's mainly all centred on London, although you do have regional centres wherever there is any power, political power, that's where you get lobbyists. So there is a centre in Holyrood, there is now a growing industry in Cardiff. But mainly it is around the Westminster Village. There is, interestingly, actually, that if you're familiar with London, there is a kind of a lobbyist corridor that we talk about, which runs between sort of the ropey end of Oxford Street, to sort of Holborn and Chancery Lane, which if you can picture it on the map, is basically equidistant between Parliament and the city, is the bridge between politics and money. And that's an easy way of kind of framing it in your mind. Now, the types of people who lobby, I'll just give you a brief kind of outline of who we're talking about. There are, for every corporation, they will have an in-house lobbying team, and that could be one person, or it could be a team of eight. Tesco's has got a very substantial one. Google's got a very impressive one. All the major corporations have them. And then there is a lobbying for hire industry. So these are agency lobbyists who work specifically. They are committed, dedicated commercial lobbyists. And if you have a problem, you will bring them in, and they will try and sort it out for you. But the thread that runs through all of these people, and we don't really know the numbers in this country, is looking at sort of 3,000-4,000 people, relatively small but incredibly powerful. If you look at the players involved, they are political insiders. So you have a number of sitting peers, that's lords and baronesses, who are also commercial lobbyists. The most famous of them is Tim Bell, Lord Bell. He runs a lobbying kind of... a public relations and lobbying group, which has a number of lobbying agencies in it. Another one is, well, he calls himself Lord Chadlington. His name is Peter Gummer. And he's David Cameron's neighbour, apart from many other things. David Cameron bought a bit of his drive, I think, for like the price of a small house a while ago. Very, very closely connected to the Tory party. So these are some of the kind of top dogs. These are the peers that run a lot of these lobbying agencies. But then... you also get a lot of special advisors who've been working within, say, the coalition government, and they will then, the door will revolve, and they'll go straight into lobbying, and then they'll come straight back out again. If you look at somebody like, there's a guy called Bill Morgan. He was Andrew Lansley's advisor in opposition. And then he went straight into a commercial lobbying firm, which specialised in health. And then when Andrew Lansley became Secretary of State, he went back to help Andrew Lansley put the NHS reforms in place. Andrew Lansley then lost his job. He went straight back into lobbying, Bill Morgan did, and now he's working for this company again. And all the while he's taking his contacts and knowledge of how policy is made and who's making it to these commercial clients. And that's how you get advantage. This is why they have political insiders, because it's not just the contacts, it's not just who you know. It is you know how the process works, and the majority of us don't. They are armed, these people, with inside knowledge that the rest of us, well, you'd have to pay for it, and that's the point. So yes, there are former MPs who are lobbyists. We try to get a list of former MPs who have parliamentary passes. By dint of them being former MPs, they have parliamentary passes. We try to get a list out of the House of Commons of how many former MPs have parliamentary passes. And in the time it took us to get this out of Freedom of Information, 5 on the list had died, right? So it took nearly 3 years to get this list. And there are about 30 or 40 who are either clear lobbyists or potential lobbyists on that list who are former MPs. So you're getting a kind of an idea of who these commercial lobbyists are. It's worth now talking about... some of the people on the periphery of it, think tanks. Think tanks, if you've ever come across them, Adam Smith Institute, the Institute of Economic Affairs, there are some newer ones, Policy Exchange Reform, and they sort of present themselves as these kind of independent bodies where they generate these ideas for policy. Rubbish. They are lobbying agencies by another name. Anybody, you talk to anybody in the commercial lobbying industry and they're just like, well, they're just doing exactly what we're doing, they're just more expensive. So they have, again, very, very good access to politicians, very, very good access to the media. You can't pick up a newspaper without reading that reform says, you know, we need to bring in top-up payments for the NHS, or Policy Exchange is saying, you know, we need to frack everywhere or whatever. But they are being paid by commercial organisations to present a particular line in the media and to politicians. So they're another subgroup. The accountancy firms, they have lobbyists within them, so the big four. There's one, Ernst & Young has got some people who are advising the government on how to reform the tax code, but they also are part of Ernst & Young's commercial lobbying side of things. So companies will go to Ernst & Young, whose pitch is, why avoid tax now that the media's all over it and there's a reputational risk from avoiding tax? Why do that? Why not lobby for that tax break instead? So if you want to lower your tax bill, don't avoid, just lobby for that tax break. So there's kind of, there's a whole range of people doing it, law firms as well as another one. So those are the people involved. I really want to focus on their tactics, and then you'll know kind of how they work, and then you can kind of track them. Because the most important thing about lobbying is it's most effective when it's secret. And this is openly acknowledged in the commercial industry, that the more noise there is, i.e. public awareness of lobbyists at work, the less effective they are. So if we can see them, and we know what they're doing, we can call them out and we can hold our politicians accountable. So they want to be, I mean, it has this very shadowy reputation, you know, behind closed doors and stuff like that. Well, that's not an accident, and it's because that is when they are most effective. So if we can see them at work and you can start calling out some of their tactics, then you can take some of their power away, is how we figure it. I should say, this brick here, I write about PR, I'm the worst PR person in the world. This is a book that we've got out, which is called A Quiet Word, came out earlier this year, and it's basically talks about all their tactics and techniques, and has lots and lots of examples in there from either tobacco, oil, fracking, HS2, whatever. But so it's all in there. I should know it better. Anyway. So the first tactic, I mean, the key thing, the stock in trade lobbyists is access. They need access to politicians. And you get access by being friends with politicians, by being former colleagues of politicians. Access means that you can have a quiet word with politicians without them having to publicly declare it, and they don't. So access is number one. But the second thing is, one of the key tactics of lobbyists is that they have to get their views across to politicians. Now, you can have a quiet word behind closed doors, but you might actually need some bit more oomph behind it. So they use the media. This is the most obvious way that they do it. Our media is full of, I mean, you know, it's full of PR puff, but it's also full of material that's been placed in there by lobbyists. And the reason they do it is because they want to either show support for their cause, or they might want to issue a threat to government. If you regulate us, we're going to pull out. News Corp did that. They said, if you want to investigate us and have a big media plurality kind of investigation or whatever, we're going to take our investment overseas. So it's a way of issuing threats and showing support. So if you take something like support, there was a while back, I think it was 2010, 2011, it was put forward that they were going to drop the 50p top rate of tax. Now, if you looked at the polls, most people in this country were staunchly in favour of keeping that tax. But there were lobbyists at work to show that there was a groundswell of support to scrap it. There was a scrap the tax campaign, and there were lobbyists brought in to do it. And what they did is they got a bunch of economists together to put a letter into the FT. They signed that letter saying scrap the tax. They got a bunch of what they called the bedrock of British industry to sign a letter in the Telegraph, and they put it in there, and the headline was, you know, 500 British businesses say scrap this tax, it is killing us. If you went through the list of the signatories, you had at least five managers from Credit Suisse on there, which is the Swiss-based financial services firm. I wouldn't call them the bedrock of British industry, but what it did is it allowed then the editorial in the Telegraph to say, look, you're killing British businesses, get rid of this tax, and they did. We've seen exactly the same thing happen on HS2. There is not much support for it in the country, but again, they ran economists in the FT, same lobbying firm, and they ran a bunch of businesses in a letter in the Telegraph, and again, it was a way of showing that there is wider support for these initiatives. And so, I mean, you all question what you read in the newspapers, but just bear in mind that there is a commercial lobbying industry who is talking to politicians through the media. The other key thing, though, is, and I mentioned this briefly before, is the secrecy element. Lobbyists are so much more effective when nobody knows that they're at work. And so one of the things, the media is sort of a double-edged sword for them. You might want to use it, but there are other times when you want to avoid it at all costs. So if you think back to the last Labour government, they put forward the idea of having a pesticides tax. And again, there was a lot of support for it amongst the public. Really, really, it was on the Archers, for goodness sake. You know, there was a groundswell of support for a pesticides tax to get rid of some of the pesticides. Now, the pesticides industry thought, you know, there's a threat. We don't want that. We're going to lose money. So they hired a lobbying firm, one of the big, big lobbying firms called Hill & Knowlton, very experienced, worked for some very dodgy people. And they ran this campaign, and the media strategy was to avoid the national press, because if it gets in the national press, you're going to start having a debate with the green groups. And what they didn't want to do explicitly was to alert the green groups to what was going on. They did not want public debate, and this is why it kind of... Well, it doesn't kind of. This is why it subverts democracy, the commercial lobbying industry. They did not want to have that debate. So they kept it out in the national media, and they are very skilled at that. Half of what lobbyists and PR people do is actually keep stories out of the press. So they did. They tried to keep it out of the press, but what they did do is they put it in the farming press because they needed the support of the farmers. They wanted to get the farmers on side. Do not bring in a pesticides tax. It's going to hit the farmers in this country. So that's how they ran the media campaign, and lo and behold, Labour dropped the idea of a pesticides tax, and that's how you do it. So half the time they are trying to avoid national coverage to avoid having any public debate. We talked a little bit about the getting their views across. They will use the commentariat, columnists in all the papers to put their views across. And this brings me on to the next tactic. If you are a major corporation, chances are nobody's going to believe what you say. They are one of the least trusted people, bodies in this country. So what you want to do is you want to put your words in somebody else's mouth, and it's called the third-party technique. Now, the rationale for this is that other people are much more likely to be believed than you. If you are a private health insurer, you want a GP or a doctor to take your message out to the public because you won't be believed. I'll give you a case in point. In sort of mid-2000s, the private health insurance industry were complaining how to get more people to take out private health insurance in this country, and it's quite low because we have the NHS. And they were complaining. If we say it, it'll be a case of, well, you would say that, wouldn't you? You just want to make profit. How do we get more people to do it? So they said, okay, we are getting some of the think tanks to say it. Fast forward to 2010, 2011, when we're having the debate around the NHS reform, you've got a think tank reform doing report after report, and media release after media release calling for things like top-up fees and more payment, co-payments in the NHS. So that's the idea of paying £10 to go and see your GP. And it's introducing this idea that we need to stop personally spending, not through taxation, to use our NHS. They didn't stop there, though. Reform... is a think tank, and so that's one remove from the private health insurance industry that's paying Reform. I should say that Prudential, which is the private health insurer, was Reform's largest donor, gave them £67,000 in 2012. There we go. Reform didn't stop there. What Reform did was like, okay, well, maybe we're not going to be believed, but we need to get some doctors. That's what we need. Everybody believes a GP, and they are one of the most trusted groups in the country. So they started this group called Doctors for Reform. Now, Doctors for Reform is essentially a front group, and it is an unconfirmed group of 1,000 doctors, is what they claim, and it's supported by the Reform think tank. So it's, again, one step removed. Now, there was a time when the NHS reforms were going through, and there was there was a massive furore about it. The doctors and nurses were out on the streets. Public opinion was against the NHS reforms. If you tuned into the Jeremy Vine show on Radio 2, this is the second most listened to current affairs programme on the BBC. It has a an audience of roughly 5 million. During all this shitstorm, they had a debate, and they called in Doctors for Reform. And so you've got this GP, who is the spokesperson for Doctors for Reform, on the Jeremy Vine show saying, no, this is what we need. We can't afford the NHS anymore. We need to start reforming it. We need to get more health insurance. This is a good thing. We must support it. Now, this guy is a GP. The fact that he specializes in Botox is neither here nor there, but he didn't mention that. But they also didn't mention, and this is a failing of the BBC because they do it all the time, they didn't mention the fact that he is supported by Reform, which took £67,000 from the private health insurance industry. And that, I mean, it's taken them off private health, private hospital for front groups. There's another one called Nurses for Reform. Ooh, even dodgier. They think the NHS is a 60-year mistake and a nationalised Stalinist abhorrence, and that's a quote. They are... But they're another front group, again, with links to think tanks like the Adam Smith Institute. There are lots and lots and lots of these groups, but they are very effective at getting on the media. And the BBC will not say who they're funded by. The tobacco industry does it all the time. You get the guy from the IEA, which is the Institute of Economic Affairs. He's saying, we don't need plain packaging of cigarettes. This is the main debate at the moment. It would be a very bad idea. It would increase smuggling and all this kind of stuff. They have taken so much tobacco money over years, I mean decades, and yet the BBC never mentioned that the IEA is tobacco funded. And this guy is on, you know, Question Time and on the radio the whole time. Anyway, so this is how effective the third party advocate, keep an eye on them. Okay, there are other front groups to mention. I mean, people like the British Nutrition Foundation, they call themselves an independent source of advice on nutrition. They are mainly sugar funded, so Nestle, Coca-Cola, the like. It was admitted by one of their former directors that they, I have to be quite careful here, but they... basically were working to prevent regulation on sugar. Sugar's got the same problem as alcohol, as gambling, as tobacco. We sort of put them in the addictive industries. Now, whilst we talk of tobacco, tobacco are pioneers of the third-party technique. And it's worth noting their kind of creativity when it comes to getting third parties. I mentioned plain packaging. This is the fight they're having at the moment, but before it was on... You know, secondhand smoke. They have been waging a 60-year war against public health measures. Plain packaging is the latest one, and they have got very creative with their third parties. So they have got, I mentioned the smuggling thing, so one of their key arguments, which is bogus, is that if you introduce plain packaging, and by the way, plain packaging is not plain packaging. Plain packaging is nasty, olive-coloured cigarette packets with massive great health warnings on them. It works on the fact that kids start smoking because they're attracted by branding, and if branding didn't work, you know, why would they do it? So they're having this fight at the moment. The third parties that they used include former police officers to take the message out on smuggling. There's a guy who's been doing the rounds at the moment of the regional press on that. They've used trading standards officers, so they've contacted trading standards officers to get them to contact their MPs. A whole bunch of people, the news agents. They launched a massive, massive campaign by funding the news agents industry body. Then the news agents go forward and they say, this is going to kill our business, but you don't see Philip Morris in the background. There's a colleague of mine who runs a thing called Tobacco Tactics. If you're interested in what the cigarette companies are doing at the moment, there's a wiki called Tobacco Tactics, which has an awful lot of information on there about that. Up against a corporate lobby group in any significant way, you will know about the attacks that they can launch. And this is a recognised part of what the industry does, and it works on the fact that you want government to listen to you and only you. You do not want other people's voices being heard that could influence your decision. And they have developed a whole range of tactics from the very, very bad. So smear campaigns, intimidation campaigns, threats, and things like that, to maybe slightly more benign but no less effective. So one of the ways that they will work is, if you look at the online space, this is another thing that they are now specialising in, which is basically making sure that all opposition groups are kind of hidden in the internet. There is a way of manipulating Google. You can bump your content up and bury other people's content way down in searches. I mean, it's a very common thing now for lobbyists to do, which is make sure that their corporate lobbying message is the one that is on the first page. And it relies on the fact that most of us don't click beyond the first page of Google searches. So they are all at it. And some of them have admitted to it, and it's always in strategy documents that you read from lobbyists, is we will sort out your Google rankings. And so you just hide the opposition's message. Yes?
If you Google HS2, you get the opposition straight away.
Well, the opposition's quite big in HS2. I think in HS2's case, they would be... the opposition is very, very well known. HS2 is quite an interesting one because we've done a little bit of stuff on them. We certainly know the lobbyists involved, and there are a lot of lobbyists involved, actually on both sides. And this is the thing. Some of the opposition groups have actually employed commercial lobbyists. They are not kind of a bunch... I mean, there are lots of residents that are going to be affected, but they have brought in commercial lobbyists, so they are probably more effective than a lot of opposition groups. What HS2 did is that they... they realised they had a bad kind of communications problem in that the government was selling HS2 on the fact that it would reduce the journey time of some business commuters by about, 20 minutes. That's not going to sell it to the country. So they realised they had to go away and rebrand it, and the way that they did it was, it's about jobs in the north. It's about increasing economic development in the north and economic opportunities in the north. Now, this is a fiction. This is a fiction dreamt up by a lobbying agency called Westbourne Communications. I can show you their office. And they ran a whole campaign on this, which was... It was their strapline was, our jobs or their lawns. And it was basically on this fiction, this divide between the rich South and the impoverished North, and it was pure fiction. Interestingly, HS2 is one of the ones that has attacked its opposition. There was an event that somebody went to, who reported back to us. It was quite a there were dignitaries at this event. There was the mayor's person for transport there, and it was not a small kind of intimate affair. It was a big affair. And the guy from HS2's lobbyist stood up and he explained what their strategy was. And I'm summarising, children cover your ears, because he said the strategy to deal with the opposition was to, quote, shit them up. Now, when questioned what he meant by that, he was like, oh, no, it could mean anything. What do you mean it could mean anything? But it's again, part of these... I can't accuse them of intimidation, but certainly they will have a massive rebuttal team. So if you put anything else out that is in opposition to HST, they will be on you like that. They are. If you are working in opposition to something like HS2, which has such political backing and has such economic backing, you are going to be, one, monitored, and two, I mean, if you're causing trouble for them, then they will deal with you some way. There is something that lobbyists do is, particularly in the online space and in the social media space, is that they have these very sophisticated monitoring systems. So if you put out an offensive tweet, offensive to them, 140 characters or whatever that they don't like, they will know about it. They talk about finding the influencers. It's probably not the person who's making the most noise. This is a quote from a lobbyist. It's not probably the person making the most noise. It's the person who's influencing that person who's then making a lot of noise. And their job is to find the influencers in this social media landscape. And so they have these very sophisticated monitoring systems where they will try and find the influencers. If you're amongst us here, good on you. You know, keep going. But just be warned. I talked about some of the more unsavory aspects of dealing with the opposition.
Can I just ask about that point you make about social media space? How do they deal with influencers? What do they do?
Well, it will be a case that they'll watch their output. I mean, a lot of it will be rebuttal, and they can use the law. So if you are putting something out that they disagree with, they will issue legal threats, and they will, you know, try and put you down that way. They will... I'll come on to this, actually, because when dealing with the opposition, there's a tried and tested strategy, and it was developed by people like Nestle, who were faced with the Baby Milk Action campaign. It was then taken up by Shell and BP, who Shell particularly with the whole Nigerian thing, the GM companies. And it's a strategy which is basically seeing your opposition looking at your opposition and then divide and rule. It's divide and conquer. And what they do is they want to isolate the radicals. So this, again, is quoting them. Isolate the radicals. And then the more moderate ones, you want to steer them towards becoming realists. And then those realists you engage with. So then you are basically, the radicals, they can go over there and they can make as much noise as they like. But we want everybody else to come to this realist position. And then we can start having a dialogue. They talk about dialogue. Dialogue with the realists. And then you can start getting them to think like you. This development's good for this reason, or this public health measure would be dreadful for this reason, or whatever. And you have basically driven a line through the opposition. And that's their strategy. You know, it's lobbyists are very fond of kind of warfare metaphors. They use them all the time. And it's what you do in warfare, and lobbyists do it all the time. So Shell did it. And like I say, the GM companies have done it. The tobacco companies have done it. And you see it with the tax justice lot. We saw it recently with that. Don't talk to these groups, but do invite these groups onto a platform. And we can start having a dialogue with some of the more moderate NGOs, but we don't want to talk to Occupy over there. They can go and make as much noise as they like, but we'll have, you know, ActionAid and the other more moderate NGOs over here, and then you've divided your opposition. So that's basically it. That's a summary of the kind of tactics that they use. There are millions of examples that I could give you, but I think I'll leave you with... So it's a slightly depressing thing. When you start to look at the lobbying industry in this country, and it is the third biggest lobbying industry in the world after Washington and Brussels, it's very sophisticated because we have a very sophisticated public relations industry, which is what it's part of. It can be quite overwhelming and quite depressing. And what can we do about it? One of the things that we've been trying to do is get some regulation for lobbyists. Now, in the States, where arguably they have a much bigger problem with corporate lobbying, they have regulation there. So if you are a commercial lobbyist, you have to say publicly on a register, this is who I am, this is who I'm working for, this is what we're lobbying for, and this is how much money we're spending. Are you spending £5,000 or £5 million? Makes a difference, you know. And we've been lobbying for this, lobbying against the lobbying industry is great. Lobbying for this lobbying register in the UK. Now, the coalition government said they were going to introduce it when they came in 2010. David Cameron, that's a quote from him, a quiet word, made this speech. It's the next big scandal waiting to happen, lobbying. We all know how it works, you know, behind closed doors, the quiet lunches, the quiet words. And they pledged to do something about it, and they said they were going to introduce a register of lobbyists. And then we could see, for example, the enormous private healthcare lobby that's been lobbying for years to get its hands on the NHS, £100 billion budget. They've done it, by the way. Education's next. We will be able to see it. At the moment, we're in the dark. Now, earlier this year, they introduced their register of lobbyists. And it's shit. It's rubbish. It won't do anything. It's a sham. It's a fake. It's a pretend register. They've done it. You know, I mean, they've pulled a blinder, basically, and introduced something that's not worth the paper it's written on. They also managed to couple it with the gagging bill. You've heard of that? That was a nice strategy on their part because you had the headlines, lobbying bill, gags, charities. And I'm like, no, it's not the lobbying bill. It's the thing that they shoehorned into the lobbying bill that this completely unrelated. But anyway, so they've done this. So we've gone back to the drawing board, and it's a case of now pressurising Labour to introduce some register so that we can just begin to have this conversation about these people that are subverting our democracy. That's essentially what they're doing. We all know about it. Everybody in this country knows about it. You look at the polls, public trust is plummeting, and one of the reasons is because we feel like we've lost our voice in government, and it's been replaced by people who are paid to speak to government. So, but I would say, other than, you know, getting a first step, a rather weak transparency measure, is just, if you are campaigning, my advice would be look for the lobby that you're up against. If you don't know them, find out. They will be there. If there's a commercial interest, they will be there. And then start talking to the media about it, because lobbying stories make good copy. And it's one way of exposing your issue, if you have an issue with something in particular, is to talk about some of the tactics and some of the inside track and the privileged access and the money that the opposition is throwing at it. So, step by step, we'll get them exposed.
Is that now open to questions?
It is, yeah.
I just wanted to play devil's advocate, really, and ask if you don't feel that our political system is so sophisticated that, of course, there will need to be a sophisticated industry, if you like, in order to negotiate with that. And that's where the lobbying, that's where lobbying comes from. That's why lobbying is what it is. But also, are there not groups that are lobbying for progressive causes that maybe are a counterbalance to the kind of lobbying that you've outlined?
Yeah, no, it's what I get. It's a very good question, because there are lots and lots of charities are set up just chiefly to lobby government. I mean, we can think of, Greenpeace is a massive lobbyist. I'm a lobbyist. I'm lobbying for lobbying regulations. The trade unions, I mean, they are explicitly lobbying government. That's what they do. But the idea that there is a somehow equal counterbalance to the corporate lobby in this country is the fiction. So when, during the financial crisis, and the British Bankers Association, which represents the city and the bankers, they were accused of, you know, a ferocious lobbying campaign. And they, trade unions and charities, they lobby too. There is no significant counter-lobby to the bankers. Let's just put it like that. So you will often get this from corporate lobbyists, that they will say, but, you know, trade unions, we have to lobby in order to get heard. Is the fact that you look at the reality of the commercial industry and why they do it. We come back to that point, they are doing it to make money. They are not doing it because, you know, for any altruistic reason. Occasionally you get that. But the majority of the time it is done for profit. And because of that, the largest investment made is by corporations. And the more money you spend, I mean, it's not necessarily the case that you throw £1 million at it and you're going to get heard. But there is a significant outlay before you can even get through the door to be heard by government. So it's this idea that there is a kind of an equal counter voice. And that's just not our experience. What is the outlay?
Sorry, can I just ask that people use the microphone so that everyone can hear, and also it's been recorded. So
my question is, what is that outlay? You mentioned earlier about the donation that Prudential gave. Is there any, what's the protocol around donations and, what is that outlay?
Well, that's one way of currying favour with government, is to become a political donor. And that's, you know, that's definitely part of it. But we're talking about, if you look at some of these tactics that I've talked about, it costs money. If you want somebody who knows how the inside of the coalition government works, and you need somebody who knows about Lib Dem politics, somebody who knows about Conservative politics, you are probably lobbying the Labour government at the moment because there's a chance they might come in. You need three insiders. Now, the closer they are to the Cameron camp, the more expensive they're going to be. So one of the major lobbying firms at the moment is a firm called Portland. Now, Portland have on their staff Alistair Campbell, the guy who used to be, it's run by the guy who was Alistair Campbell's deputy. It has two former heads of communication from Number 10, one under Gordon Brown, one under the coalition. It has a guy who wrote the coalition agreement, so all the policy there. These people do not come cheap, but they can get, I mean, you know what's going on inside government if you've got that kind of insider on your team. And that costs. Now, if you look at their client list at the moment, it's Google, it's Apple, it's the Russian government. Now, they also do lobby for the Scouts, I should say. They lobby for the Scouts, but I'm guessing that the Scouts money isn't supporting that, those, that kind of staff. Is the money coming from Russia at the moment to massage its reputation and make sure that sanctions don't happen and all that kind of stuff. So if you want the best, you've got to pay for it.
I think we're living in interesting times, because I haven't caught the whole gist of what your presentation was about. But for example, I sign probably half a dozen, maybe more, petitions per month via email that I get from org and this and that and whatever. And maybe a third of them have a result our way, like get 100,000 signatures on this or that. And I think we're emerging into a global consciousness. This is an age of information. We have instant access to truth through the internet. It's like a double-edged sword. If we look and share and link in together, anything is possible. You're right, we do live in a corporatocracy. Power and money is concentrated in super elites that have run the show for 300 years or more. But Babylon time is slowly emerging and changing into Zion way, or a better way. That's my hope, that's my dream anyway. Together, anything is possible. Thank you.
I would say information is power. The more information that we have, the more powerful we become. But there is so much that is secret. If Occupy could know the caliber of the lobbying agency that managed to get all the news coverage away from the Corporation of London, so it wasn't focused on them, it was focused on how expensive their tents were and how they went to Starbucks and all that kind of stuff. There was a lobbying agency, one of Lord Chadlington's lobbying agencies, who was in there at the time working in a, they call it, you know, crisis management mode to sort out the coverage. Now, if we know about that, then we can start thinking, oh, okay, that's what we're up against. We don't just accept the headlines, not that we do anyway, but, you know, there is a... The one thing that we, that certainly with this book and the work that we do, is trying to make it real that their influence isn't automatic. Influence is constructed, and it's constructed using these techniques. Get your insiders, get the media, get your third-party people, get rid of the opposition, get in there, job done. And it's not as straightforward as that, but it is constructed using a set of tools. It's like building a bridge. If you want to get from A to B, you want to get rid of that piece of regulation, this is what you've got to do. And that's why people employ lobbyists. So once we understand that more fully, I think then we can start to really counter it.
Yeah, the point was, it runs over from the previous talk I saw earlier on, which is talks about infiltration. And there's an infiltration about the police into left-wing agendas and parties and groups. And it got me thinking, actually, about how almost the opposite is true, where it is almost an element of the left or the liberal or anybody. There's a lot of infiltration going on. So you get, it'd be worth a point when I work in a building services engineer, as an engineer, and I'm in a building consultancy, and everyone's like, oh yeah, just bang in all those systems. And I feel like almost like an infiltrator, where I'm in there, oh well, yeah, put energy saving measures in, and you know, put this bit of PIR in there. Excuse me. So I feel like an infiltrator in a funny way, where they're just banging it in there and sorting out this big system. The same thing could go in a political business, where you're, to make that change, you could stand outside and shout about it, but what you really, to make that change, you want them to you want to make that influence, you want to get in there and infiltrate them. And you show them what to do rather than tell them what to do. So you almost have to make that movement inside the entity that you want to change. If you want to steer a car, you've got to be inside the car to steer it, I suppose is what I'm trying to say. So the same thing goes for environmental issues, social issues. You want to be inside those positions of control and steering where you're going to be inside that vehicle if you want to direct it.
Yeah, I agree with you totally. I think we should all, you know, I am certainly not a great supporter of our political system as it is, but it's the only system we got at the moment. So I'd say get in there, and there are an awful lot of good, really good MPs, not that they have a lot of power at the moment, but, you know, the government does listen to them sometimes. But I would say also to that point, Gully, that what's happening at the moment is that they are learning from us. So there is now a move in this country, which the states have seen for many, many years, towards astroturfing. We're starting to see it a lot more here. So it's the kind of the construction of fake grassroots movements by corporations. And there are lobbying firms set up just to do that. HS2 did it to an extent. It's ever so prevalent in the states. I mean, billions of dollars are spent on it. And it's a way of, you know, kind of, yeah, showing that there is grassroots support for your corporate position, yay! But they are borrowing from us now, so it's slightly depressing. There's a guy at the back.
Hello. I work for the NHS, okay. And I love it. And I work with people who are really passionate about what they do. And I've seen massive changes in the 10 years, and it's been quite scary. Transport patients is private, our cleaners are private, our IT is private, and I'm kind of thinking, what's next?
All of it.
I mean, we're not private, no. And we work for the NHS, and we're very kind of proactive in what works best for patients, but I don't know if you have any...
It's a piece of work I'm doing at the moment, so it's all a bit work in progress. But certainly there are... when the reforms were coming through in 2011, we did a bit of work and started to look at some of the people that were paying the think tanks, that were getting close to our politicians through lobbyists and the like, and you could see them positioning themselves. And now what we're seeing is quite difficult to track, because a lot of it's on the local level, so you have all these commissioning groups and it's very disparate. But if you can start to track it, there are some of the big contracts that are coming up at the moment. You can start to see some of the people that are within those networks around those commissioning groups. I am not optimistic about it at all. You look at some of the people, the KPMGs, the PwCs, the McKinseys, the big US health insurers. I mean, they want so much. They want the business. They want the data. We've got this enormous data set in the NHS. I mean, pathology, hospital, running the hospitals, I mean, everything basically apart from A&E and maternity, you know, which are really expensive. But it's, I mean, they want the lot. So the NHS, I don't know, we all just gather and know what's going on, and, you know, I'll keep you posted wherever we find out, but it's, you know, it's really bloody difficult. The one thing about the NHS that absolutely heartens me is there's so many people doing stuff. If I want to find out what's going on in Cambridge, there's a group, and they know, and they're active, and they're on the ground, they're outside their hospital, and they're there. Mm. Same, I mean, not all over the country, but there are some incredibly, incredibly dedicated people. And the unions are doing it. I mean, I think watch this space up until the general election, because it will be very interesting. Mm. I think... Well, one thing if I've got time, I don't know. Education, nobody really is talking about very much, about the privatisation of that. It was, I caught the end of the Steiner, how to set up a Steiner school talk before we came in. And I think as a counterbalance to that, I would say keep your eye out for what's happening in online and digital education now, because those players are starting to come in. Andrew Lansley did the health reforms in a kind of a massive piece of legislation. Let's show everybody what we're doing. It caused a massive furore about it. Michael Gove did it very quietly. Done it very, very quietly. And I think now we're seeing some of the players, Google and Apple are two that are in it, but there's a lot of US companies. Murdoch is invested in digital education. You've got the big players like Pearson. But I would start to look at some of the players that are now coming in. We just had the first application from an online school, and it's because it's cheaper. You can educate children on a laptop, working through software. You can get double the number of pupils per teacher. There's a book that Michael Gove says is an excellent book, which is called Liberating Learning by two US think tank people. But they basically say digital education is a way of undermining, they're explicit about it, it's a way of undermining teacher power and the unions. And they, I mean, it's I find that very concerning, almost as concerning as the NHS stuff. So.
Thank you.
Sorry, this is really depressing.
A lot of stuff that you've been talking about has been at sort of national and sort of international level. And I was just wondering, at the local level, you know, regional and sub-regional, whether lobbying is used in a big way there. And I'm thinking particularly about these things called local enterprise partnerships. A lot of resources being sort of given to those partnerships to spend in local areas. And they're not accountable, they're not elected, they've got no complaints procedure. In Bristol, for example, a big influence is through Bristol Airport. A lot of campaigning at local level, but quite tricky. And I wondered if you got any sort of insights that might help people operating at that sort of level, regional, sub-regional level.
It's a really good question, because it is a big part of the industry. There's a chapter on it in here. It's the lobbying at a local or regional level. There are agencies that specialise in this, and mainly it's to do with planning, and that could be planning application for an airport or for a shopping development or for a supermarket, or, you know, whatever it is, or an incinerator, nuclear waste facility, whatever you want. But it's a way, again, of making sure that your political objective is the one that's passed by local politicians. So they've introduced this thing now. I think if you're going to have a development over a certain size, you have to consult the public. You have to consult locally. So we have this rash of public consultations now, but they're lobbyist directed. So you will often find, you know, that there's a poor community that's in Plymouth, Portsmouth, I'm going to get it wrong. But they've just had an incinerator dumped on their doorstep and there was a public consultation. Well, of course, the decision was made prior to the consultation. It's a tick-boxing exercise that you'll see developers do, but they are invariably run by the lobbyists that are hired by the developers. And it's a way, again, of neutralising the opposition, because you steer people to saying, this is your time for your voice. We're going to listen to you. And you give them a managed environment in which to air their concerns. And then you are informed about the opposition in that area, and then you can tackle it. And it's a way of kind of, there's a guy who was a Tesco's lobbyist, and he said, you know, the army used to call it reconnaissance, we call it consultation. And so the public consultation, I mean, there are people who do it well, but invariably it's a way of getting development through. So I think be very aware of the companies that specialise in your area, and finding out the public relations. Often they are public relations and consultation stakeholder engagement specialists. They call themselves a whole rash of things. Find out their relationships with the developers. There is a voluntary register of lobbyists at the moment where I can give people details of this. You can find some stuff about, you know, who's hiring who at the moment, and then you can trace it from there. There are ways of finding out.
I mean, one of the tactics they use in consultation is that they don't ask you whether you support or oppose or neutral on a particular proposal. They just ask you specific questions about aspects of the scheme.
Yeah, they're letting you change the colour of the bricks.
Yeah,
that's
yeah,
it.
Yeah.
Do you want this much grass or do you want this
much
grass?
Like that,
you can't say no. There is no no. Yeah. The no is not an option.
Absolutely.
How many trees do you want to chop down?
Yeah.